పవర్ ఎలా పవర్ వచ్చిందా
సార్ సార్
పవర్
పవర్
వచ్చిందా
వచ్చేసింది సార్ కరెంట్
ఓకే
వచ్చేసింది సార్ పవర్ వచ్చి నెట్ కూడా వచ్చేసింది అండ్ వీఆర్ లైవ్ నౌ సార్ వీఆర్ లైవ్ నౌ సో సో ఐఎమ్ స్టార్టింగ్ యువర్ ఇంట్రడక్షన్ సార్ ఐ విల్ స్పీక్ ఫర్ జస్ట్ 2 to 3 minutes సార్ we heartily welcome from Maharaja's College of Pharmacy for accepting our invitation as a resource person and promoting your a very valuable message and a lecture for our audience and participants sir I take the privilege on behalf of Maharaja's College of Pharmacy to introduce Dr. M. Murali Krishna sir to the participants Dr. M. Murali Krishna sir obtained his masters and doctorate from Andhra University in 2001 and 2006 respectively he is presently assistant professor Andhra University College of Pharmaceutical Sciences he worked as an SRF in DoD funded national projects during drugs from Indian Ocean AU2 he carried and presently carrying out several projects from CSIR DST SERB AICTE RPS MODROBS etc He carries out various administrative roles like associate director NMR research center Andhra University placement officer AU College of Pharmaceutical Sciences nodal officer APSHI he filed a patent on design synthesis and pharmacological evaluation of benzimidazole and benzimidazolium derivatives he had published 19 national and 26 international research papers in several indexed journals he contributed a book chapter titled kinase inhibitors from microorganisms and a book on anti tubercular drug therapy he developed certain softwares like AU Docker LE and AU Docker for virtual screening and ligand optimization he conducted organized and participated in several workshops training programs faculty development programs on various modern analytical instrumentations he is an active member of professional bodies like APC APTI IPGA etc we welcome you sir for our FDP program and you can please start your lecture sir
thank you Usharani for
thank you sir
introduction and first of all I thank professor Uday Shankar and then Usharani for choosing me to deliver a lecture in this FDP my topic is actually on mass spectrometry so before I start my seminar I have a word because in case of spectral identification or spectral analysis which is a very important part of pharmaceutical analysis in any organic laboratory or analysis laboratory spectral analysis because we cannot separate spectroscopy instruments from pharmaceutical sciences because our job starts from identification of a compound authentication of a compound so that's why every student need to know basics about spectroscopy and how to at least read the spectrum so I would be giving you the seminar especially to let you familiarize with the mass spectral reading as well as its analysis okay I hope I will appreciate this lecture let me share screen yes hello Dr. Uma Dr. Usharani hello hello can you hear hello Usharani okay we'll start then So friends, this is my presentation. So in this presentation, we'll see in detail about analysis of mass spectrum for identification of organic compounds. So here, I'll be discussing some of the important key points for reading mass spectrum, as well as a few tricks and tips that we have for efficient reading and efficient extraction of data from the mass spectrum. Okay, so this first slide, actually it should tell you the very objective of mass spectrometry. So this is the white powder is what we have usually have in our hand all the time with a question. Okay, so this white powder could be glucose or starch or sodium cyanide. We don't know what it is unless we know something about the constituent of this powder. So whatever we can perceive from outside is only the bulk property. So that's why we need to know. Hence, the nature of the compound is translated into some kind of computable data by using an instrumental technique from where we get the structural information. Okay, so here mass spectrometry helps us immensely. First of all, in case of structure of organic compound, so that is the very objective of finding the structure of organic compound, to know what exactly is that white powder. So in structure of an organic compound, basic things that we need to know is, first one is its elemental composition. Okay, so what are the elements with which the compound is actually made up? And then we need to compute the molecular formula. From there, we can get the molecular weight and the data. This is one part. The second one is, so how actually these elements, or otherwise the atoms that we have in the compound, are joined together to form a functional group. So different types of functional groups that are present in an organic compound. Then the molecular framework. So what type of a structure is there inside the organic compound? Is it a benzene or naphthalene, or is it a steroid, or is it a flavonoid? So the molecular framework is to be determined. And then we need to finalize the structure with the 3D distribution of all these elements. Okay, so this is the way how information regarding structure of an organic compound is needed. So these are all the various things that are needed to know entire chemistry, entire structure of an organic compound. So for each one of them, we have different techniques, or some of the techniques can cover a little bit more than one or the other aspect. Because in case of elemental composition, if you wanted to know, elemental analysis is the technique. From there, molecular formula can be determined. Molecular weight can also be determined. And functional groups, we can simply do chemical test or go for IR spectroscopy. Our molecular framework, we can go for proton NMR. For 3D structure, we can go for X-ray crystallography. So here, one technique, like if you take a simple mass spectrometry, it can help you obtain information regarding elemental composition, molecular formula, and molecular weight. So this is the way. Okay, so different types of techniques can be used for identifying structure of the organic compound. But what exactly are the techniques that we have right now for molecular weight determination, and how actually mass spectrometry is advantageous? So in case of molecular weight determinations, we have three types of techniques are there. One of them is absolute method. So in absolute methods, they allow the molecular weight to be calculated directly from the measured quantities. Okay, so we actually measure a quantity related to its chemistry or internal nature or in the basic properties of an organic compound. So from there, we try to get the information regarding molecular weight. So here, we don't take into consideration any kind of information. The physical or chemical structure of a molecule is not required. Okay, so these are what we call them as absolute methods. So here, to give you examples like colligative properties, like membrane osmometry, ebulliometry, cryoscopy, vapor phase osmometry. Like ebulliometry means depression in boiling point, depression in melting point. So these are directly connected to number of moles of a compound, or otherwise weight of the compound or molecular weight of the compound. The next one is X-ray scattering, like light ray scattering. X-ray crystallography comes into this category. And equilibrium sedimentation is also another method that we have for determination of molecular weight. These are all the old methods available for us. The next one is equivalent methods, means we take a little bit of information from the chemistry of the organic compound, and then we join these bits and pieces together to obtain the complete molecular formula. So So here comes the end group analysis of a protein. So maybe you may have this idea about protein structural elucidation, okay? Sequencing of a protein. There, C and C terminal analysis as well as N terminal analysis. There, we already know something about the amino acids. Okay, we have 20 amino acids are there. Regarding 20 amino acids, we have the information. Then we start probing into the structure of the organic compound by using these 20 amino acids and their data as the information that is available. So these methods are what we call them as equivalent methods. The third one is relative method. So here, a physicochemical property is taken into consideration, especially viscosity, like thing. Then viscosity of a compound and its molecular weight is related. Okay, so measurement of viscosity of dilute polymer solution is the most important technique as far as these methods are concerned. So dilute solution viscometry can be used. So these are the three methods that people have been using from the beginning for determination of molecular weight. So how can we choose one over the other? So it all depends on your actual target. Okay, like because these are the methods that we have, and if your working range is more than 100 Daltons, 100 is the molecular weight, then you can go for X-ray crystallography, because X-ray crystallography can be used for any type of crystal which can diffract X-rays. Okay, so in the same way here, membrane osmometry, okay, and end group analysis, because these are peptides, so we can go for even higher molecular weight compounds. And here if you see the other compounds also, they can be used for specific section of different types of compounds. So here ebulliometry, cryoscopy, etc., colligative property related experiments can be done for compounds whose molecular weights are less than 10,000 Daltons. Okay, so this is the way how various techniques people have been using. And the colligative properties are one of the prime or a very important critical techniques people used in the beginning for determination of molecular weight. Jacob H. Vonhoff, who discovered the rules and regulations of diffusion, he was awarded Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1901. He is the first person to get Nobel Prize because Nobel Prize distribution began in 1901. And he is another important person who discovered instrumental methods for determination of elemental analysis. Okay, so these are the two very important persons as far as these techniques are concerned. Now let's see how actually mass spectrometry is different from the earlier, and why actually we needed mass spectrometry. So if you see elemental analysis also, the error percentage is 0.4%. 1 to 0.4% is the error that we used to see. And in case of colligative properties or diffusion based, etc., they can give you molecular weight. Depends on the type of nature. Because if you take insulin's molecular weight is approximately 1500 Daltons. But some of the scientists determined it as 3000 Daltons. Some of them determined the molecular weight as 6000 Daltons. It is like that. Because when a molecule forms a complex, so that reflects in the molecular weight. Okay, so that's the reason why these techniques are not very much accurate. Their error percentage is very high. Some of the techniques like elemental composition cannot be used for molecules with molecular weights above 1000. So these are all severe limitations, and some of the compounds cannot be studied at all. So this is what made people to look for an alternate technique where mass spectrometry was discovered in that way. So in simple, in case of mass spectrometry, here they coupled, because they actually take the compound in vapor phase, because this technology takes into consideration a few physicochemical properties. Like you take the compound and then ionize it, then we force the ions to travel with certain velocity. So in this velocity, it will help us in differentiating the ions. So when a charged particle is traveling, okay, so it behaves as a magnet. This magnetic component of the compound, the element is used for deflection. Okay, so here they use a magnetic dipole, so thereby magnetic field, so that it deflects the ions at a particular angle. So when it is deflected, here centrifugal and centripetal forces work, thereby it will allow the ions to segregate. In basically in any type of mass spectrometry, you will have an ion source, and then there will be some sort of analyzer which will separate the ions, and at the end you will have a detector to recognize all these ions, and ultimately all these data will be translated into a spectrum. Okay, because here in this lecture we focus more and more on analysis of a spectrum, so that's why I'm not going to spend more time on instrumentation and the principle behind all these techniques, but the basic setup is this one. So here we have a compound whose physicochemical property, especially the weight of the compound, is determined by forcing the molecule to go into an ionic state, thereby then they will let the ions to travel with certain velocity. So this is common aspect in all mass specs. Then they will use either electricity or magnetic component or the frequency with which they can travel, and then they will use appropriate analyzer over here, either magnetic sector or quadrupole or ion trap, etc. So thereby they can collect, separate the ions, and then ultimately detect the ion to give us clear information regarding the molecular, the kind of ions that are present. Okay, so one of the ions, as we are giving certain energy over here, it is obvious that molecule may get degraded, so that you can see so many peaks. So like this you will have a spectrum. From this spectrum we can read out the information regarding weight of the ion. So let's see one by one, the way how we can read the mass spec, and then what kind of information we can extract from the mass spectrum. So this is one of the examples here. This is the mass spectrum for ascorbic acid. So basically, when a spectrum is given to you, what are the things that you need to read from there? What happened? Okay, so first one is molecular ion peak, because when ionization happens, one of the electron from this compound is knocked off, so that the odd electron containing compound behaves as a carbocation. The carbocation is generated, that we are going to get over here. And then because this has so many functional groups and energy is given to this one, it is in ionic condition, so it gets degraded, fragmented, and the ion with maximum stability, because when in the previous slide you have seen that ion has to travel some distance, so in this travel ion may get degraded. Some of the ions which are stable, they appear in large quantity, so that they appear as 100% relative intensity. This is what we call it as base peak. And the remaining smaller peaks that we have, we call them generally as fragment ion peaks. Okay, and what kind of information we can derive? Molecular ion peak gives us information regarding molecular weight as well as molecular formula. Okay, so these are the two things that we get. How we can get the molecular weight data as well as molecular formula is what we are going to discuss at length in this presentation. Okay, and the fragment ion peaks are going to provide you structural framework, means whether a compound is a steroid or flavonoid or a particular or a lipid or fatty acid. So that information we can get, as well as presence or absence of functional groups, like presence of hydroxy group, carbonyl group, or a benzylic group. So all these things can be determined by just looking at the fragment ion peaks. Okay, so this is the information we can derive from mass spec, basically for organic compound structure analysis. Other ions are the terms that you need to remember is metastable ions, means ions that can form between ion source and a detector. detector. So they cannot be detected by using detector because they will die in the middle while during the travel. So this is the second term you need to remember, that is quasi-molecular ion. Quasi-molecular ion means sometimes, because when ionization is done, sometimes these ions associate themselves with other metal ions or otherwise other chemical fragments, so that it is not the M plus ion which we usually get, but M plus plus metal ion, like M plus plus sodium ion or M plus plus methane ion in case of chemical ionization. So that type of complex ions are what we call them as quasi-molecular ions. The third one is parent ion and daughter ion. So these terms clearly indicates that, let's say if a base peak 116 is actually giving you a fragment ion peak at 85, okay, then 116 is what we call it as parent ion, and to this 85 is called as daughter ion. And when you take only these two, 176 and 116, this molecular ion peak is actually giving base peak, okay? So this get degraded and then an ion is formed, which is actually appearing over here as base peak. So here this molecular ion peak is called as parent ion and this base peak is called as daughter ion. Isotopic ions are cluster, okay? So this will help us immensely, because isotopic ions means, let's say here you can see a big peak is there at 176 and near to that one more small peak is there. Okay, so these are what we call them as, for any element, let's say if you take carbon, carbon 12 and carbon 13, both can exist, okay? So, but carbon 13 is 1.1% only, is present in 1.1%, that is what we call it as isotopic abundance. So, that's the reason why in any kind of mass spec, there is a possibility of presence of M plus ion. Along with M plus ion, you will also see M plus 1 ion, sometimes M plus 2 ion also, okay? So that one you have to carefully observe, because you may sometimes take M plus 2 ion as the molecular ion. Let's say if you had taken M plus 2 as the molecular ion, then you would think that, like, you may wrongly interpret the spectrum, like M plus 2 is the molecular ion, let's say in your idea. Then M plus ion will be considered as a fragment for you, okay? M minus H, it is like that. So that's the reason why you have to be very careful regarding observation of isotopic ions, cluster. What is M plus, what is M plus 1, what is M plus 2? So these you have to clearly observe. So now let's go to the individual items, how you can extract the data. Let's say molecular ion. Molecular ion provides key information on both molecular weight as well as elemental composition. Okay, and the requirements of the molecular ion. So how can you identify the molecular ion, as well as how can you determine whether an ion, that is whether a line that you can see in the mass spec, is actually a molecular ion or not? There are three important things are there which we need to remember. One is, it must be the ion of highest mass in the spectrum. It must be the ion of highest mass in the spectrum. Second one is, it must be an odd electron ion. Okay, because in mass spec, you will see ions that possess, that are arising because of knocking out one electron in the beginning, and then that will give you a neutral fragment and a cation. That neutral fragment will further get ionized. Okay, it must be the odd electron ion which was formed in the beginning. It must be capable of yielding important ions in the high mass region of the spectrum by loss of logical neutral species. Okay, if you have to find out whether a compound can give you such and such molecular ion or not, it is not only the molecular ion, but so many fragment ions will be there. Let's say you know something about the compound. Let's say you have done some chemical test and found that compound has carboxylic acid group, COOH group is there. Then the molecular ion will be that type of an ion from where, if you minus 44, means carbon carboxylic acids usually degrade, losing, they will lose carbon dioxide. Carboxylic acid unit as carbon dioxide. CO2 loss will be there. So you will see loss of either 44 ion or 45 ion. M plus minus 44 or M plus minus 45. If this ion is also there, then the first ion will be considered as molecular ion. Let's say if you have OH group is there, primary hydroxy group or secondary hydroxy, then obviously M minus 18, OH will be removed as water molecule. So in this way, it must be capable of yielding important ions in the high mass region. Because as you go further into the low mass region, so many fragment ions are possible. So you will find a fragment where almost any type of molecular degradation. So that's why in the beginning, on the higher side of the molecular mass spec, molecular weight, okay? So you will have to see on the higher side, whether there is any logical loss of neutral species is there or not, okay? But you need to remember one more thing. So these are the rules to define whether a peak can be considered as a molecular ion or not, okay? So if an ion accepts all these three, it doesn't mean that peak can be considered as a molecular ion, okay? So that's very important, because let's say you have a peak at the end of farthest end of mass spec. Yes, okay, it is an odd electron ion, okay. The third one is it has yielded certain fragments which are matching with our logical conclusions, but still you cannot confirm that is the molecular ion. We need to do a few more things, okay? But if a molecular ion is there, okay, so you have to consider, you have to fix one peak as a molecular ion, it must follow all these three rules, okay? So this is the way. These are mutually exclusive. Next one is the presence or absence. Okay, molecular ions, they sometimes will not form. Molecular ion formation, its intensity, where it has to appear, all these are dependent on, one is functional groups, type of functional groups a molecule is possessing. Second one is the type of compound. Third one is type of ionization used. Okay, so in the beginning, functional groups. Let's say you have a simple hydroxy group, primary hydroxy group. Then there is a possibility of presence of a significant quantity of molecular ion will be there. But let's say if the alcohol is a tertiary alcohol, then there is always a possibility that alcohol will be removed easily, because dehydration reaction happens very easily on tertiary alcohols. So that's the reason why the possibility of finding a molecular ion for tertiary alcohol is very, very less. And then type of compound. Okay, so the type of compound means whether you are testing a thermostable compound or a thermolabile compound, a compound with ketonal tautomerism or so many molecular rearrangements, if they are possible, you cannot sometimes possibly find out molecular ion for the organic compound. Yes, the instrumental technique is good, but ion formation, okay, sometimes the ion cannot sustain the travel, the distance that it has to travel from source to detector. Then third one is type of ionization. Regarding this, we have in the coming slides, I'll explain you in detail how actually the type of ionization is going to significantly alter molecular ion. Okay, friends, molecular ion, identification of a molecular ion itself is the first and very, very important step in the structure analysis of an organic compound, or the reading of mass spectrum. Okay. So from, let's say, now you found that molecular ion is there, and from there, how can we derive information? Okay, the first one that we need to see is elemental composition. So we need to get information regarding elemental composition, and molecular ion is critical as far as elemental composition is concerned. So how can we get the information? Let's see. There are two methods are there. One is with the regular EIMS, electron impact, or GCMS, or otherwise ESMS, means low resolution mass spec techniques. From there, how can we derive the information? In the second part of my lecture, I'll show you how to actually high resolution mass spectral analysis helps you identify elemental composition. So this is the table which tells you about natural isotopic abundances of common elements that can be present in organic compounds. So here, natural isotopic abundances of common elements means, let's say if you take carbon, carbon 12 can be there, carbon 13 can also be there. Okay, if you take 100 atoms of carbon, there is always a possibility that at least 1.1% of all those atoms are going to be C13. So if you weigh carbon, okay, 100 atoms of carbon, let's say each one of them, you presume that they are 12, but they always end up in giving you a value slightly more than 12. Okay, so that's the reason why. So here, this is M, this is M plus 1. Okay, so here you will see in the elements, okay, only M plus contributors will be there. Like in case of fluorine, you can see there is no M plus 2. So only M plus ion is going to be observed in mass spec. Whereas in case of carbon, you can see M plus 1 ion will come, as well as nitrogen also, N14 and N15. Both isotopes can be there. So these are what we call them as M plus 1 contributors. And here, if you see halogens like chlorine and bromine and sulfur and silicon, you will see M plus 2 ion also. Okay, so significant portion of, let's say here in case of bromine, M plus ion and M plus 2 ion, both are almost 50-50. Whereas in case of chlorine, it is 3:1. In case of oxygen, it is 0.2%. In case of silicon, it is 3.4%. In case of sulfur, it is 4.4%. So that's the reason why, if those elements are present, you will see a significant intensity of M plus 2 ion is going to be observed. So from this information, how can we derive information regarding elemental composition? Let's see. I'll give you one example. So this is one of the example where you have a mass spectrum, very simple compound, very small compound, less than 40 molecular weight. And this is the data. Okay, at 36, you have 100% intensity is there, 37, 4.1, 38, 33. Okay. So if you compare this one, 33 is the molecular ion and 38 is the M plus 2 ion. So what is the percentage? 100 and 33. So is it matching with the chlorine? 100 and 32. Okay. So when M and M plus 2 ions are there, there is always a possibility of presence of chlorine in 3:1. If the intensity is 3:1. Let's say we again go for this one. So here, in case of this spectrum, we have M and M plus 2, 94 and 96. Intensity is 100% and 96%. Okay, almost 1:1. So if your mass spectrum has M and M plus 2 in almost equal proportions, the only element that can give you this type of a pick is bromine. Okay, bromine 79 and bromine 81. Are present in almost equal proportions. Okay, so in this way, M plus 2 ion is going to significantly help you identify whether particular elements are there or not. Let's say if you have two bromines, how many ions will come? M will come, M plus 2 ion will come, M plus 4 also will come. Okay, so there will be binomial distribution of the intensities will be there. Now it is 1:1. If you go to two ions, like two bromines are there, then M, M plus 2 and M plus 4 will be there. Their intensities will be 1:2:1. 1:2:1, like in case of Pascal triangle. And then if you have three bromines, what will happen? Four peaks will come. And then 1:3:3:1 ratio. So it is like, it is the way how, if an element is there, M and M plus 2 will come, and then if multiplicity is there, like too many halogens are there, you can see accordingly the change in distribution of the intensity for M plus 2, M plus 4, M plus 6, M plus 8, and so on. Interestingly, it is not the presence, but it is the absence of ion which helps us significantly. Let's say there is a clear indicator that M plus 2 peak is not there, then it clearly indicates absence of chlorine, bromine, sulfur and the silicon. Okay, so if there is no trace of M plus 2 ion is there even after repetition, then you can say for sure there is no presence of chlorine, bromine, sulfur and silicon in the compound. I hope you are understanding this. It's a simple logic only. Now let's see one more example where we'll discuss about M plus 1 ions. Okay, so far we have seen M plus 2 ion and its contribution. For carbon, let's say here we take one example, carbon, carbon 12, carbon 13. Okay, M and M plus 1 ions are present in 100:1.1. So this is the ratio. In the absence of other M plus 1 ion contributors, like in case of sulfur, M plus 1 ion contribution is there, 0.79, it can be there. In case of silicon, oh, 5.1 is big, okay, silicon, huge. And the remaining, like nitrogen and oxygen are also there. Carbon percentage is only 1.1. So in the absence of silicon or other M plus 1 contributors in the compound, then the ratio of M plus 1 by M plus 1.1 into M plus into 100. So this is the formula which is going to give you indication of number of carbons. Number of carbons. We'll do one small calculation here. Okay. So in the absence of these are the M plus 1 contributors, we'll do one calculation. Let's take a pen and paper and then you can work it out. See here, 58 is the molecular ion. Okay, so here we have this one. 58 is the molecular ion and this is the M plus 1 ion. Okay, so here. Now can you calculate how many number of carbons are there? So here, this is the formula. Please take a pen and paper and then try to do this one. M plus 1 by 1.1 into M plus. If you substitute everything, 0.5 by 1.1 into 12 into 100. It is going to come at close to 3.78. Okay, so 3.78 means it is close to 4. Okay, so there is a possibility of presence of 4 carbons in the organic compound. Tested for here. Okay, so this is the way how number of carbons can be determined by using M plus 1 ion. M plus 1 ion. But here you will always end up, because you will get some kind of idea on the possible presence of 4 carbons, because 3.78 is close to 4. That's why we are rounding it up to 4. These calculations will work because all these are primitive mass spectral analysis. So all these analysis are going to help you with small molecular weight organic compounds. These cannot be applied for heavier molecular weights compounds, and more than 1000, if you go more than 1000, the error will be more. Okay, so to solve this problem, scientists have proposed using a high resolution mass spectrum. So in case of mass spectrum, in case of any spectrum, the minimum distance or minimum difference that you can clearly see between two peaks is what we can trivially say, we can say as a resolution. Okay, so if you can see clearly two peaks, one at 1.00005, the other one at 1.00006, the difference is 0.501. it is like that. So that is the resolution. Older instrumental techniques, the mass specs that I have shown you, where the accuracy is going up to only one digit, 1.0. But if you see the elemental analysis, elemental or otherwise atomic weights, they'll go up to four digits we take. Okay, so these are the actual accurate atomic weights of different elements. Like if you take 1H, it is 1.00782504 is the accurate atomic weight up to how many digits? 8 digits. Okay, means 10 power minus 8. Okay, so up to that one. But in case of in our textbooks also, usually they represent atomic weights only up to 4 digits, 1.0078, only up to this one they represent. At least up to this one, if your mass spectroscope, if your mass spectroscope can give you two signals at, let's say here, 1.0078 and 1.0077, okay, at fourth digit, if you have the accuracy, that type of mass spectra, mass spectrum is what we call as high resolution mass spectrum. Resolution can be increased by you choosing appropriate analyzer. Okay, if you take magnetic sector analyzer, it is not a high resolution mask. Or in case of a quad pole or tetrapole, so octopole, so in all these they are high throughput techniques, but they are not high resolution techniques. If you are using ion trap or ion cyclotron type of analyzer, so they are they can give you highly resolved mass spec, and even time of flight also can give you high resolution mass spectrum. Okay, so when you have high resolution mass spectrum, at least up to 5 digits, okay, so then you can verify, you can use that type of data to obtain molecular formula as well as to verify molecular formula. Let's do one exercise here. I'll give you one spectrum. So this is one example of mass spectrum, high resolution mass spectrum. You can see here 390.17928. So at this value, up to this value, we are getting the resolution. And this one 389.18162. Okay. Let's say, and this is the compound. I'm also giving you the structure. So this is the compound. This is the molecular formula. Now you have to verify. So this is one way. Okay. So when this molecular formula is there, one is we can determine the molecular formula. Okay. So high resolution mass data is usually analyzed by the software. And we don't do the analysis, but software can do the analysis, because if you see carbon, hydrogen, boron, oxygen, and how many elements are there? 110 elements are there. For all of them, accurate atomic mass units will be there. They will give a program in such a manner that they will do combinations, permutations and combinations by keeping in view valence, bond theory, all types of theories that we have in the bond formation. The program is going to analyze various permutations and combinations of elements which are matching with this high resolution mass data, whatever we got, up to fifth digit. Up to fifth digit in ppm level, you can have accuracy, you can have variation. But don't be surprised if I say that if I give this molecular formula to the software, it can hardly find two molecular formula can be assigned to this one, to this molecular ion. Okay, so it is that complicated. Okay, so when you give data up to fifth digit like this, 390.17928, to the software, it will give you, one is this molecular formula, and you may get one more molecular formula in the calculations which is coming close to the your molecular formula. Okay, so it is that tough. So that's the reason why in HRMS, if you submit the sample, they will give you two data. One is molecular formula data, second one is regular mass spectrum. Okay, these are the two data that they'll give. Let's say here, now we wanted to verify. Okay, so this is the molecular formula that is given, and this is the structure of the compound. How can we verify? So when you calculate, when you substitute the accurate atomic mass units of each one of the element and then calculate, up to fourth digit is enough. It will come up to 390.1770. Okay, so what is it that we have got here? 390.1790. And if you do the calculations, the error will be 5.8 ppm only. 5.8 ppm is far, far, far less than whatever we can get from the traditional molecular weight determination techniques. Like in case of elemental analysis or otherwise in any other technique, at least 0.4% is the error. Less than 0.4% error need to be there. Okay, then only we can accept it. That is the old rule. Now here in HRMS, the error is at ppm level. And not only this one, we can also verify with the fragments or otherwise other isotopic peaks, because m plus 1 or m minus 1 like that. Because here we have boron. In boron, we have boron 10 and boron 11. Both will be there. Boron 11 is dominating peak. So that's why this one is actually B11 containing compound. So this one will be, how many peaks will come? Here we have 3 borons. So let's say if this is boron, 3 borons, 3 M plus. Here 2 of the borons are in M plus and the third boron is M plus 1. This one, one of the boron is M plus, the two borons we have are B11s or M plus 1s. Here all the 3 borons are present in M plus 1 level. So that's the way how this isotopic cluster is coming. Isotopic cluster is coming. And now if you because this one B11's atomic weight is this one, B10's atomic weight is 10.01294. If you see the difference, this is the difference. Now this is, these two are the values that you will get by deducting 0.99637 from this value. Okay, from this value, if you remove, okay, so you can because from this is M plus 3 actually. From here, if you minus 0.99, this is not these two, this is point only, 0.99637. You will get this value. From here, if you remove one more, you will get this. Okay, so this is 3890 is matching. You should get 389, but here what is it that we got? 389.1816. Here it is 389.1829. 388.1866, 388.18517. They are pretty close. And if you do the calculations properly, you will get errors around 3.3 ppm for the first one, 3.6 ppm for the second one. Hence, all these peaks are matching. Hence, you can confirm that this is the molecular formula this is the molecular formula, that by using both the molecular ion as well as the fragment ions. Okay, so this is the way how we can derive information from the molecular ion. So far what we have seen what is a molecular ion, from molecular ion what kind of information we can derive. One is elemental composition, idea on elemental composition, and quantitative information also. The second one is elemental formula from high resolution mass spec, both obtaining elemental formula, because elemental formula calculation we don't do, only the software will do that. Verification part can be done by us. So here further a few more information helps you in the analysis of mass spec. One is nitrogen rule. This is a very old and popular rule. So if you see the compounds H2O, its molecular formula is 18, CH4 16, and if you see all these molecular weights are even numbers. Okay, and if you see the presence of nitrogen, when nitrogen, only one nitrogen or nitrogen in odd number, if it is there, you will end up in having an odd mass weight, odd mass number. Okay, molecular weight will be odd. But when nitrogens are present in even numbers, again you will get even number mass molecular weight. So this is what we call it as nitrogen rule. When in the absence of nitrogen, or when nitrogens are present in even number, you will always end up in having an even molecular weight. Okay, so by just looking at the molecular weight, let's say if it is odd, if it is an odd number, you will have immediately conclude that the compound possesses One, nitrogen is there. Second one is, if nitrogens are there, either one or odd numbered nitrogens in odd number 1, 3, 5, 7, etc. Okay, it is that kind of conclusion you can draw. So friends, now we will see individual ionization techniques and how actually we are going to get the molecular ions or otherwise mass spectra, information regarding mass spectra. So far we have seen what type of information we can derive from mass spectrum. Okay, but in case of mass spec, especially because all other techniques including IR, NMR and other spectroscopy techniques, you will not find much difference in the output of the spectrum, their applications, or you know, instrumental setup, you will not see much change. But in case of mass spectrometry, you have different types of ionization techniques, different types of analyzations. Okay, these two combined, okay, like EI can be combined with quad pole, or EI can be combined with magnetic sector, or CI can be combined with magnetic sector, or otherwise ESI, okay, electrospray ionization can be combined with quad pole, it can be combined with this one, other ion cyclotron, etc. So when you change the combinations, the type of ionization technique is going to alter the type of molecular ion you are going to get. Okay, so EIMS is one of the oldest techniques that is available to us. So this is, in true sense, we call it as mass spectrum. Okay, where molecular ion can be seen, you will not find any kind of quasi molecular ions. Okay, only M plus one is observed. It's a hard ionization technique because you take the compound and then apply energy. So thereby you are giving a lot of energy to that for ionization. Sometimes it may get degraded. Okay, so you will get either a molecular ion, or most expected peaks are like thermal degradation products are going to be obtained, like dehydrated product, decarbonylated products are going to be obtained. Logical loss of neutral fragments is the key to the recognition of a compound, especially in case of EIMS, because the total fragment ion analysis can be done only with the EIMS, because the remaining ionization techniques, we call them as soft ionization techniques, they are meant mostly for the molecular ions, not for the total fragmentation, especially for the molecular ions. Nitrogen rule can help you judge the molecular ion peak, especially for elemental composition. Classical mass fragmentation patterns are observed, because if you see the type of mass specs that we refer to all the time, take it for granted, like lipids, steroids, terpenes, whatnot, all these compounds, whenever we are talking about mass fragmentation, McLaferty kind of rearrangement, etc., etc., we are always referring to EIMS, where in the mass spectrum, you will see classical mass fragmentation patterns are observed. Okay, and large library of digitized spectral data is available, so that's why searching is possible. So now, if you take any kind of fatty acid, okay, fatty acids can be converted to methyl esters, and if you submit it for GCMS analysis, you need not do much analysis component of a spectral analysis thing. Because when the data is digitized, when so many algorithms are evolved, the spectrum can be analyzed digitally. A software can help you in obtaining the outputs. Okay, so steroids, fatty acids, etc., many volatile organic compound libraries are available. So that's why it helps you in the analysis of the mass spectrum. But whenever you need classical type of mass spectral analysis, you have to go for EIMS. It is not meant for thermally unstable compound and high molecular weight compound and non-volatile compounds. Okay. Next one is electrospray ionization technique. Because in case of electrospray ionization technique, how actually the spectrum looks like and what type of ions are observed. Electrospray ionization technique is actually HPLC, because in case of LCMS, you will see HPLC solvent coming from this side. Here you will find the spray which gets evaporated, and then it undergo coulombic fusion. Ultimately, ions are generated. So here in the liquid, we ionize compound not with some kind of energy from outside, like in case of electron impact or something like that. But here we use buffers for ionization of compounds. Let's say if you are using non-volatile buffer, usually ammonium acetate, ammonium formate, formic acid, etc., all these are used. But if an ion is there, like sodium, potassium, etc., or carbonate, formate, if it is there, in case of electrospray ionization, both positive ion and negative ion can be determined. In positive ion mode, you will have M plus H ion or M plus Na plus ion. In negative mode, M minus H ions are detected. Okay, so these are quasi ions. Okay, but here, because this is a soft ionization technique, you will most probably you will not get so many fragmentations. Molecular weight is calculated from the cluster of multiply charged ions sometimes. I'll show you one spectrum. All these are representing one compound only. But when this evaporation is happening, okay, so ultimately you are supposed to get single charged ion species. But let's say if the evaporation did not happen properly, and in the detector, even these multiply charged ions can also end up over here, or else they may couple with other chemical fragments that are available in the environment, because you are using buffer and other reagents, and if it is a mixture of compounds are there, they may react with themselves, and then so many quasi ions are going to be formed. So spectrum looks like this. So you have to be very careful here. Molecular ion, if you wanted to observe the molecular ion, it will be M plus H or M plus Na. So here you need to inquire what type of buffer they are using. In case of chemical ionization, this is again another type of technique where already ionized chemicals are used for ionizing another compound. This is what we call it as reagent gas. A reagent gas is nothing but ionized gas, which will be used for colliding with the target compound so that the energy is transferred and the target compound gets ionized. So that is the way it will go. Here also, like in case of the earlier ESI, the problem with here is because here also positive ion and negative mode can be run, but 99.99% of the cases, even chemical ionization spectrum also, you will see positive ions only. Methane, isobutane, ammonia, etc. are used as reagent gases here. Quasi molecular ions are pretty common in this case. M plus H, and depending upon the reagent gas you are using, M plus C2H5, M plus C3H5, depending upon the type of reagent gas you are using, quasi ions are going to be formed. So you have to be very careful while picking up the molecular ion. The next one is Fab mass. In case of fast atom bombardment, okay, so instead of reagent gas in case of chemical ionization, so here we use atoms. Okay, we use atoms like fast particles like xenon, neon, etc. So we activate them, and then we use that energy for ionizing the reagent species. So in case of Fab mass, we keep the sample mixed with a matrix, and then that matrix is spread on the probe plate. So fast atom particles are going to collide, and then that are going to create the ions. So here there is always a possibility that your ion is going to mix with the matrix. Okay, if glycerol is used as a matrix, peaks like 45, 57, 75, etc., all these are going to appear, which are not a part of your compound fragmentation. Okay, so it gives you a lot of confusion. So that's why Fab mass became not very popular, because it is one of the best techniques for it was projected as one of the best technique for identification of mass for compounds with more than 5 kilodaltons molecular weight. But because of this complexity, Fab mass was replaced with so many other techniques. Now MALDI is dominating macromolecular mass spectral analysis. See, for example, if you take this compound, okay, so some compound is there for which molecular mass spectrum is given to you. If you go by normal rules, what should be considered as the molecular ion? So we have to consider 653 as the molecular ion. Okay, so it got degraded and it got degraded, it will go like that. But it is not giving us any kind of a logical fragment. But actually the molecular ion is 2-level. Okay. And if you see FADMAS, you will see M plus Na ion can also be there. If you see all these ions, 211 is M plus Na, 233 is M plus 2Na plus H, 399 is 2M plus Na, 443 is 2M plus 3Na plus 2H. So this is what is the kind of confusion it is going to create. So that's why FADMAS or otherwise these soft ionization techniques usually are taken for one confirmation. Along with this, they will also take the help of other spectral techniques for confirmation of molecular ions. Okay, so they have their own application in specific fields. So in this way, you have to be very careful in picking up molecular ion, and you always have to see what kind of ionization, what kind of analysis, what kind of reagents are used in generating the ions. Next one is MALDI, matrix assisted laser desorption ionization. So here analyte is actually, because the compound is mixed with a matrix, like in case of FADMAS we are using glycerol, etc. But here we use a matrix which contains so many double bonds like cinnamic acid esters, etc., so that laser, when used, these double bonded molecules absorb energy to some extent. They sometimes get heated up, degraded, but they protect the molecules. So at least some of the molecules that are mixed over here, they get enough energy so that they can get ionized. So in this process, they also get evaporated. Okay, so this is the way how MALDI works. Here again, ions, you may or may not be able to get proper molecular ion, and you will always, 99% of the cases, you will end up in having a quasi ion. But right now MALDI, lot of developments have happened in MALDI, especially in case of peptide analysis, where MALDI, matrix assisted laser desorption ionization, is the ionization technique used, and then time of flight is the analyzer used. So MALDI TOF is an indispensable tool in proteomics laboratories right now, where most of the analysis is done automatically. In case of mass spectra from APCA, APCA is the interface we use for LC-MS. The problem as well as the remaining things are the same as CA. Okay, you always have quasi ions. The only difference is here we use atmospheric pressure. And the second one is ionization starts from electrons emitted from a filament, where the ionization APCA starts from a corona discharge. Corona discharge means here high voltage discharge is going to be there. So that generates the ions. One more thing that we need to understand here is, okay, when molecular formula is determined, from molecular formula, what kind of information that we can get? One information only, tip only I am giving you here. Let's say if you see the molecular formula here in hexane, C6H14 means CnH2n plus 2. This is alkene, C6H12. So because one double bond is there, one hydrogen is lost, CnH2n. This is again CnH2n minus 2. So whenever a double bond is there, one mole of hydrogen is lost. So if you take any of these structures, the number of hydrogens that are needed for this structure to be converted to a straight chain alkane, okay, complete saturation, okay, that number of hydrogens that are needed is what we call it as hydrogen number or number of unsaturations or degrees of unsaturation. So all these are the same. So we have one formula here, where when a molecular formula is given to you, ఓకే సో 2c plus 2 plus n minus h minus x by 2 is the formula which gives you number of unsaturations or index of hydrogen deficiency. So many names are there. C is carbons, H is hydrogens, X is halogens. Okay, because hydrogen and halogens both are to be counted together. N is nitrogens. Let's do one small calculation here. Let's say I give you C7, H6 and O. Can you please calculate and then tell me how many unsaturations are there? Okay, so we have C7, H6 and NO and O. 2 into 7 plus 2 plus 0 minus 6 minus 0 by 2. So it is coming up to 5. 5 unsaturations are there. What does it mean? 5 unsaturations means 5 double bonds. Or 4 double bonds and 1 ring, or 3 double bonds and 2 rings, so on and so forth. Every pi bond is accounted for as one unsaturation, because if you have a triple bond, C triple bond C, so that is considered as two unsaturations. Let's say if you have a cyclohexane over here, it has one unsaturation because it needs one mole of hydrogen to open it up. So this is actually the molecular formula is for benzaldehyde. So in benzaldehyde, you have benzene ring. We have 3 double bonds, 3 unsaturations, 1 ring is there, 4 unsaturations. In aldehyde, C double bond O will be there, 1 unsaturation. So 5 unsaturations are there. Molecular formula with unsaturations and simple data can help you figure out or almost complete structural elucidation of organic compounds. Okay. So this is the reason why from the beginning, if you go through B-Pharm-C natural products chemistry, okay, so there in case of any kind of organic compound analysis, be it terpene like citral or reserpine or any other kind of organic compound, the first thing they do is elemental analysis, so that from elemental analysis they will get unsaturations. From unsaturations you can now do the calculations to find out how many rings can be there, how many different types of groups can be there. So that, let's say you know that 5 unsaturations are there. Oxygen is there, na? So now for oxygen, how many functional groups can be there? You can have an alcohol, you can have aldehyde, you can have ketone, you can have ether, like this. 4 or 5 functional groups will come. You simply do the functional group analysis. For this aldehyde group, if it is there, CHO, one functional group is gone. Okay, if you remove CHO from this, what will remain? C6H5. What is the meaning of C6H5? It's a benzylic unit. Yes or no? It's a benzylic unit. So in this way, it's the simplest way to solve structure elucidation puzzle. So here, mass spectrometry helps you immensely in obtaining this molecular formula. Okay. The second part of mass spectral analysis is fragmentation analysis. Okay. So there a few tricks are there which I am going to tell you. Because in this short duration, we cannot delve into each one of the fragmentation pattern and its analysis. But I'll let you know about some of the tricks that we have so that they can help you. So deriving compound structure from mass spectrum, or this is what we call it as fragmentation analysis. Fragmentation analysis is done to obtain information regarding the structural framework. So usually mass spectrum is used in such a way that in case of, let's say if I am doing any kind of a compound analysis, my journey starts with mass spectrum and my journey ends with mass spectrum. In between, I take the help of IR, NMR and the remaining techniques. Okay, because I have to begin with molecular formula, and from there I think of, okay, this formula can be there, this structure can be there, this functional group can be there. All of them are to be analyzed with IR as well as NMR. So once the analysis is done, once I assume or otherwise suggest a structure, dependable structure for that, then I'll go for fragmentation analysis. So whether the proposed structure agrees with the mass spectrum or not is what I have to verify at the end. So that's the reason why our journey starts with mass spectrum and ends with mass spectrum. So here we have three things. One is analysis of the fragment pattern. Second one is diagnostic degradation pattern recognition. The third thing is computer assisted mass fragmentation analysis. So these are the three things that we do. So let's see one of them, analysis of the fragmentation pattern. So here, presence or absence of functional groups, structural features, whether steroid is there or whether benzene is there or not, all these things can be obtained by using fragmentation analysis. Confirmation of a proposed structure can be done only via fragmentation analysis. So let's say these are some of the popular ions that you can lose from mass molecular ion. Okay, let's say if you have M-18, let's say in your mass spec you have M-18, what does it mean? It means that you are losing a water molecule, means it's a simple dehydration. So when you are dehydrating, means what kind of functional group is there? Obviously you have a hydroxy group. So this, it is like that. Cyanide can go, because whenever we have CN bond, it can go as a cyanide. You can lose a fluorine, you can lose carbon dioxide, etc. Okay, so this is the way how I'm just showing you some of the fragments here. We have more than 100 different possible ions which can logically lost from molecular ion. A very, very big table is available. Like when you have carbon dioxide is lost as lost because of presence of COOH group. And some of the some of the fragmentation patterns like Mac-Lafater rearrangement, alpha cleavage via Mac-Lafater rearrangement, they are all standard rearrangement or otherwise degradation patterns. When observed, it confirms presence of a particular structural feature in the organic compound. So that is the way how fragmentation analysis helps us. The next one is diagnostic degradation pattern recognition. Let's say you are working with a natural product research, and then you have isolated some steroid. Okay, now you know it's a steroid because you can do a simple Lieberman-Bouchard test. That will tell you about presence of a steroid nucleus. Then, or otherwise, if it is a triterpenoid, so pentacyclic triterpenoids like this. So standard degradation patterns are available. So let's say you have a compound with a similar kind of structure, but some kind of a functional group over here. Let's say you have some kind of a functional group over here, some R is there. Okay, then if you see the fragmentation analysis for this compound, you will not be able to find M plus ion, same M plus ion will be different, obviously. And then the first degradation peak, here we are supposed to get 448 as the ion, but you will not get this compound, this peak. But all the remaining fragments, all these fragments are going to come. What does it indicate? It says like up to A, B, C, D, four rings are okay. On fifth ring, you have some kind of a substitution. So there actually, it is helping you in both recognizing the skeleton that is present, because the fragmentation pattern is so diagnostic, so specific for a particular skeleton. So it helps you find out the diagnostic information. Okay, so let's say if you have some substitution over here, then what will happen? None of these fragments are going to match with the original fragmentation observed. Okay, so here you can so here this indicates that there is some kind of substitution over here. In this way, fragmentation ions can help. Sorry, something happened. So here, in case of steroids also, we have the standard degradation patterns are there. And here, the databases are there, because if you feed this information to a software, like NIST database is there, which is integrated into almost all types of GCMS instruments, if you feed the data, instrument, the software itself can tell you by just looking at the fragmentation pattern, it can identify the compound for you. Okay, so in this way, the characteristic fragmentation, diagnostic fragmentation pattern helps us both identify the core structure as well as identify the organic compound. The third one is computer assisted mass fragmentation analysis. Here, especially, I'll give you one example as peptide sequencing. In case of peptide sequencing, if you see the Sanger's methodology, where we can use certain chemicals to tag either C terminal or N terminal, and then hydrolyze the protein into smaller fragments, and thereby we can determine, we can chop off amino acids from either C terminal or N terminal one by one. Okay, that is the technology. In case of mass spectrum also, in case of mass spectrometry, in case of peptide bond, let's say this is the peptide bond. This is the only possibility. Bond between CN, N and C double bond O, C double bond O and C over here. So these are the three possibilities we have. How many amino acids are there? 20 amino acids are there. How many possibilities can be there? So if you feed all this data into a computer, the computer will do the calculations for us. How? It will do the automatic analysis and it can suggest us the kind of amino acid sequence that can be there, that can be assigned to a given mass fragmentation data. So this is the general sequence that we use for peptide analysis, where when you have cell culture, from cell culture we isolate a protein. Protein is digested by using different types of enzymes, so that smaller protein peptide fragments are coming. So this will be sent through LC, liquid chromatography, so that individual protein fragments are obtained. Each protein fragment is sent to mass analysis. So here we usually go for MALDI TOF, or otherwise ESAMS, ESA TOF also can be used. Then for individual peptide fragment, you will have mass fragmentation pattern. As we are using soft ionization, extensive degradation is not going to happen. And then the peptide sequencing can be analyzed by using softwares. So many softwares are available right now, which are going to provide you peptide sequence in no time. Sanger worked for almost a decade for structure analysis of insulin. And with that developed technique, he could elucidate the structure of oxytocin and many other protein hormones in a couple of years. But now, don't be surprised if I say that if I take a protein fragment and then if I submit it for mass analysis in a couple of days, mostly in 2 or 3 days time, you can get the amino acid sequence from the simple mass fragment analysis. It is automated. So this is one of the softwares we have. This is a software from Bruker company, which can do the peptide analysis. So friends, I hope I am able to tell you something about mass spectral analysis. We focus more and more on how actually we can derive information from mass spectrum, especially molecular formula and elemental analysis and molecular formula. The fragment analysis can be done by, from compound to compound, fragment analysis is going to change because degradation patterns are going to change. So in conclusion, I'd like to tell you that mass spectrum provides information on molecular weight, elemental composition, functional groups, and presence of specific structural features and identity of the compound. So all these can be done by using mass spectrum analysis. So friends, I thank you all for your patient listening, and if you have any doubts, you can contact me.
Sir, there is one question, sir. Could you please tell about HPLC MS-MS analysis?
Yeah. So in case of HPLC MS-MS analysis, only thing is the sample is introduced by using HPLC as the interface, because from HPLC, compound that is eluted is submitted to mass analysis. So their electrospray ionization is the only technique that we have for introducing LC to MS. Now the recent techniques like atmospheric pressure, APCA, is also available. The second part is MS-MS analysis, means two parts are there. One is preliminary mass analysis, the second one is degradation analysis. Further analysis can be done, like in case of triple quadrupole, like in case of ESI MS, the ions that are obtained are sent through one analyzer, that is a regular mass spectral analysis. But next phase is, if you need to study one fragment, one ion only, so that is selected and sent through second fragmentation, that will be given energy again and sent to the next analyzer. So in that way, in simple way, okay, let's say you are analyzing a sample for which so many fragments are coming. A mixture is submitted, so many fragments are coming. Now you wanted to know which fragment is giving you which molecular ion. Okay, what is the parent ion, what is the daughter ion, if you wanted to know. So that can be done by using MS-MS analysis. Okay, so because in the first quadrupole, selected ion can be allowed to go out. All the remaining ions will be screened there. So when a selected ion is sent from first quadrupole, that will go to the second quadrupole and further fragment. So thereby you can know what is the parent ion, what is the fragment ion. Okay, so that is one of the major application. So which helps us in performing both bioanalytical work and drug metabolism studies, etc. Yeah, I hope I answered your question. So for fragmentation analysis, Gauri, fragmentation analysis, we do have certain softwares, like because online tools are available. Some of the softwares like Chemdra also, okay, help you to find out expected molecule, expected fragmentation pattern for a known structure. But we do not have too many free softwares for regular compound analysis. Let's say if you give steroid structure to a simple software, it is going to give you the structure of a steroid. That type of softwares are not there. Either it is integrated into some kind of instrumental technique, or we have web tools are there. Some of the very few tools are available, because mass degradation pattern, EIMS only, is totally studied for which databases are available. So whenever you have a database, then statistical analysis can be done. For the remaining techniques, CIMS, etc., for all of them, we do not have any kind of database. Only exception here is peptide analysis. Yeah, phytochemical analysis can be done, but there is a limitation. Okay, so I have heard of people using GCMS for extract analysis. No, when you are submitting, two problems are there. One is you have a natural product extract that is to be analyzed, okay, and you have a mixture of purified compound. Okay, let's say you have isolated a monohydroxysterol. Monohydroxysterols will never come as a single entity. They'll come as a mixture of compounds. Like even you cannot even isolate beta cytosterol. So when you have a mixture of purified sample, pure compound, almost pure compound, so that can be submitted to GCMS, okay, by appropriate chemical modification, because you need to do a preliminary analysis. At least you should know whether it is a fatty acid or a steroid or something like that, so that you can perform some kind of chemical modification like etherification, esterification, and submit the sample for GCMS. Then GCMS will give you a dependable data for lipid analysis, volatile ion analysis, terpene analysis, steroid analysis, acetylated sugar analysis, GCMS is the golden standard right now. It is not the though we have LCMS methods are there. As far as phytochemical analysis is concerned, GCMS helps you significantly over here. But you cannot submit an extract. In principle, I don't agree with people submitting extracts to GCMS analysis, because extract contains hundreds of compounds sometimes. So let's say you wanted to do acetylation. If you add acetic anhydride, there are 100 different reactions are possible. So probably you will not get any kind of data. Second thing is, when it is injected, it will clog the column. Column chemistry is going to be destroyed. So that's why I don't suggest anybody to go directly with the extract. But you go for individual compound mixture, like a steroid mixer, fatty acid mixture, etc. So quasi-molecular ion is simple, okay? So when in case of LCMS, M plus H ion is observed. So in case of LCMS, what happens is molecule is not ionized in the classical manner. In EIMS, what happens is molecule receives energy, thereby electron goes. So that an odd electron ion is formed, that is going to be considered as the carbocation, okay? But here, it is like you take salicylic acid in a water in a beaker. Then if you add ammonia to that, what will happen? Salicylic acid is going to be ionized. Okay, salicylate anion is going to be formed, as well as on the other side, you will have ammonium ion is going to be formed. So this salicylate anion is an ion. Okay, so that ion can be detected by using ESI. But here, this ion is actually M minus H. In the same way, let's say if it reacts with sodium and M plus sodium, okay, so that ion, if it is formed, sodium has positive charge, okay, so it interacts with some kind of electron rich area in the organic molecule, it forms an associate. It's not a salt, it's not a complex, it forms an association. So this entire thing is going to be considered as the ion, because sodium has the ionic charge. So that's why you will have M plus sodium, M plus 23, that ion will come. So that type of molecules are what we call them as molecular ions or quasi-molecular ions. In case of CIMS also you can see, FABMAS also you can see. CIMS or CEMS, what is CEMS? In case of chemical ionization mass spectrum, CIMS or capillary electrophoresis mass spectrum, is it correct? So if it is capillary electrophoresis and mass spectrum, let's say the thing is very simple, like mass spectrum is like a detector, okay? From anywhere, any kind of a sample, that if that can be submitted to the mass spec, so that can be integrated, hyphenation can be done, integrated, okay? So capillary electrophoresis means what? So you are going to let the sample move through a stationary phase through electrophoresis, okay? And once the electrophoresis is done, what will happen? So in case of electrophoresis, the bands are observed, okay? And then if those bands are submitted for mass spectral analysis, it can be done. Even TLC can be integrated with mass spectrum right now. In case of APCI, that is what people are working on right now. When TLC plate can also be integrated with mass spectral analysis. Okay, is there any other questions are there? What is the difference in the instrument of MS and HRMS? Only analyzer. In case of quadrupole or magnetic sector, the kind of resolution that you can achieve is less. So that's why, especially in case of quadrupole, their objective is high throughput. Let's say from HPLC, liquid is coming continuously. So that's why you need a high throughput analyzer system. Okay, quickly it has to, continuously it has to separate the ions. But in case of HRMS, their objective is to separate two ions efficiently. Okay, their ion trap or ion cyclotron technique is used. That is the technique which gives you best resolution. In the analyzers only, the difference is there in between MS and HRMS. In case of MS, most probably you can go up to 3 digits. Means if your molecular weight is 120, if you submit it for regular mass spectral analysis, the number that is that will be there in the mass spectrum will be 120.02 or 03, something like that, up to only that level. But if you submit the sample to HRMS, it will be 120.03421, up to 5 digits. They'll give you the value. Okay, so if your accuracy is at the 5th digit, you can get a clear idea on the molecular formula. So HRMS is exclusively used for determining molecular formula and its verification. As far as the instrumentation is concerned, the only difference is analyzer. So I found the predicted mass NMR in ChemDRA completely differs from original. Yes. Yeah, that will happen because the predictions work on statistical manipulations. Okay. So for any kind of statistical exercise, you will have an error. So whether the p-value or otherwise so many other parameters are used, whether the analysis is dependable or not. Okay, so with that error percentage, it will work. Secondly, the sample that you are submitting, okay, so is not always, you will not be able to get 100% pure sample. Okay, so you need to be very frank here. The NMR sample that we submit need to be 99% pure. Okay, more than 99% pure. You can never achieve 100% purity. But what about the softwares? They work in vacuum. They presume 100% purity. So that is one place where we have errors. The second thing is temperature, kind of energy that we use, the voltage that we use in the accelerator plates, velocity of the ions. They are never fixed. Okay, some kind of variation will be there. Instrumental errors will be there. Instrumental variations will be there. So they are going to alter a little bit because we need to give 10 power minus 6 torque. Okay, vacuum need to be there in the path length. Is it really possible all the time? So there will be some error. Reagent gas that we use in case of ESAMS or otherwise like this. So many instrumental variations will be there. They may result in uniqueness in your mass spectrum. They will not always match with the expected values. Okay, Renu Kari, volatile oils can be identified by using LCMS. Yes, anything that can evaporate and anything that is at least thermostable, they can be submitted to GC because the temperatures they use over there is close to 200. Okay, so that's the reason why it must be volatile mostly and it must be thermostable. And then MS helps you get the identity of the compound. So volatile oils can be submitted to LC-MS. In fact, that is one of the best methods that we have. Always there will be uniqueness. Okay, so if you see citral or lemongrass oil, where citral concentration is very much high, which is thermostable, appreciably thermostable, that can be submitted to LCMS or GCMS. But when your sample is thermolabile, in that case we need to go for alternate method. LCMS also can be done. Yeah, why not? It can be done. But the problem is you need to be very careful regarding selection of column, optimization of mobile phase, and then you think of volatile ions. Any chemical can be analyzed by using column chromatography. Okay, HPLC, wherever HPLC can be used, LCMS can most probably, it can also be used. But the only thing is you need to be careful regarding fixing of this one, column. GCMS, phytochemical filtered diluted sample of phytochemical extract, then with the database tool, can we use not in case of natural products, column clogging effect doubtful? David Paul, in case of GCMS or for any kind of MS techniques, sample submission technique will be there. Sample preparation technique will be there. Let's say if we submit an extract, that extract is not going to be injected directly into the column. Okay, no person will do that. No analyst will do that. Even when you dilute it significantly, if you significantly dilute it, it will lead to identification problem will come, because if you go below certain level, your compounds are not going to be identified. Because in case of phytochemicals, let's say your sample contains vincristin. Let's say you diluted the sample. Then do you think you are going to get the vincristin peak in the mass? I don't think so. In case of phytochemical filtered and diluted sample phytochemical extract, then with the database tool, can we use it? So I don't think we have a database tool available for comprehensive natural product identification. We do have databases, EIMS databases are available, NIST database is also available. They are mostly used with EIMS or GCMS. Okay, column clogging effect, why I use the term is, like when you have a natural product, when you submit that one for GCMS, they will not directly throw it into the column. That's the problem. So they'll have to evaluate whether it can be injected into GC first. So that's why they will do the pre-chemical modification, like they will do esterification or etherification. So you are chemically modifying your extract. Okay, you don't know what is there in the extract. When you are using a chemical extract, what will happen? 100 reactions are possible. So that's why I'll never suggest anybody to submit extract, crude extract directly. But you just put a column, get a fraction, which is containing specific type of chemicals at least, not chlorophyll and the proteinous material, etc., etc. Okay, so then you will get at least dependable data. Otherwise, some data will come. We are not supposed to provide extracts first. No, it is never suggested. I will not suggest that one. We always are supposed to submit organic compound mixture that the data that is obtained from the mass spec, that's it. So we always are supposed to submit the sample, whether it is a liquid or a solid, it doesn't matter. You have to submit it like that. But we need to partially purify the mixture. It is not like NMR, where from a, in case of NMR, you simply have to dissolve it in a deuterated solvent and put it in NMR, so that whatever mixture that is there, it is going to be represented in the NMR spectrum. But mass is not like that. In mass, it is a degradative technique. You are going to submit that one to heat, energy. So if more chemicals are there, they react with themselves. So some kind of a mass spectrum will come where so many reaction products will be there. So wrong representation, wrong results will come. So that's the problem. So any more questions are there?
Sir, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Sharani. I hope they understood what I am saying. Am I voice audible?
Yes, sir. Okay. It is very, very, very well audible, sir.
Thank you.
So all the questions were well answered, and they're very much satisfied with the answers, sir, the participants.
I want to just sum
up the lecture, sir. We are very thankful for your very detailed lecture on interpretation of mass spectra, sir. So you have clearly explained about the identification, how to identify the structure of an unknown organic compound, and different methods for determination of the molecular weights of the organic compounds, interpretation of mass spectra, and and with that, how to find out the unsaturations for fragmentations, elemental compositions, etc., to find out the structure of organic compounds. In this process, you have very clearly given an insight into mass fragmentations, ionizations, analysis of fragmentation patterns, diagnostic degradation patterns, computer-assisted mass fragmentation patterns. Thank you so much, sir, for this detailed lecture and accepting our invitation as a resource person, sir.
Thank you.
And would you like to speak?
Yeah,
hello, Murali.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine, sir. Power so is nice. There?
Yeah. I just came back. So nice. I've been hearing your lecture all through my drive from Vizag. So nice, and I could see. I congratulate you for getting around 3 crores to the funding to the university. It's very nice, sir. And I've seen many papers, 40 papers you have published. And I would like to request you one thing. Lecture delivered as a resource person, lo meeru 6th undi sir. CAD online tools for learning and practice. Nagarjuna University lo tamaru icharu. If you have any time, I would like you to deliver something like that in our college for all faculty.
Yeah,
the crucial role of web-based educational tool in the drug discovery and development.
Yes, sir.
అది మా దగ్గర ఏమన్నా మీరు రిపీట్ చేయగలిగితే వి షుడ్ బి వెరీ వెరీ
యా తప్పకుండా సార్
థ్యాంక్ యూ నేను ఆఫ్టర్ ది కంప్లీషన్ ఆఫ్ ది ఎఫ్డిపి ఐఎమ్ గోయింగ్ టు విజిట్ ఎవ్రీ రిసోర్స్ పర్సన్ సార్ థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్ థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్
సో ఐ విల్ లీవ్ సార్ నౌ థ్యాంక్ యూ
Thank you all the participants.
Amma ushara ninku unta nenu
sir
unta ninka
okay sir thank you sir I thank all the participants. Hope you have a good you had a good session. We will be posting the feedback forms of today's session in next 1 hour into the WhatsApp groups, Telegram group, as well as to the mails. Thank you all. If any queries are there, you can please mail your queries to the FDP mail ID. Thank you all.